Welcome back to Real Clear Radio Hour, brought to you by the Competitive Enterprise Institute. I'm your host, Bill Frezza. Calling in for the second half of our show is Virginia Postrel, the past editor of Reason magazine, the author of The Future and Its Enemies, former columnist for The Wall Street Journal and The New York Times, 2011 winner of the Bastiat Prize, and currently a columnist for the Bloomberg View. Virginia, welcome to the show.
Great to be with you.
Virginia, as a longtime fan of yours, I have to confess I'm a bit flummoxed to be doing this interview. When we started planning the show, you were on the top of the list of guests I was hoping our producers could land. Your libertarian feminism has been such a breath of fresh air, and yet here I find myself interviewing you about your new book called The Power of Glamour. Whatever possessed you to write such a thing?
Well, you know, I never expected to write a book about glamour because I am somebody who is very interested in the unglamorous side of things, the unglamorous side of the market. I did a piece for the Boston Globe some years ago that was about operations research and logistics. I like how things actually get done, all the things that get hidden in our glamorous views of the world. But having been asked to write an essay on glamour, I found that I became fascinated by the subject. And the reason is that glamour is a very deep phenomenon. It's a form of communication and persuasion, like humor, that creates a certain feeling in an audience and can have a big effect on how we think about the world and on our actions. And I wanted to understand that. And if you think about it in terms of sort of politics, I think of myself as writing and thinking in the classical liberal tradition, which is a tradition that stretches back certainly to the Scottish Enlightenment, thinkers like Adam Smith and David Hume, who were concerned not just with issues of government and of economics, but also with issues of the imagination and of what it meant to live in a commercial society. The world was changing around them the way it's changing around us, and they were interested in that, and I am too. And so I think it's part of a broader attempt to understand what it's like to live in a free and particularly a commercial society.
You work very hard in your book to build a proper definition of glamour, distinguishing it from style, celebrity, or fame. Can you unpack that for us?
The key insight that came to me when I was working on the book is that glamour is a form of communication that is analogous to humor, that there is an audience and there's something or someone glamorous in the same way that there's an audience and something or someone humorous. And whether or not it's glamorous or humorous depends on the emotions that are evoked.
Doesn't always
in the
work.
Audience. So in the case of glamour, when something is glamorous to us, we feel a pang of projection and longing. If only life could be like that. If only I could be there. If only I could drive that car. If only I could be with that person, whatever it might be. So that is the sort of feeling that it produces. And then it puts us in touch with some ideal, something that is different from and better than our regular life. And then the other thing I do is I unpack the elements that all forms of glamour have. And those are a promise of escape and transformation, grace. Glamour is an illusion. As I mentioned, it hides things. It hides costs.
It's effortless.
Difficulties. And that's where the grace comes in. And the third element is mystery.
So would you say it's pretty much Hollywood and the advertising industry that have a corner on the glamour market?
Absolutely not. And that's one of the things that this book is really trying to dispel, is the idea that somehow glamour was invented by Hollywood or advertising, or that it's unique to them. Certainly, there's a lot of glamour in Hollywood. There's a lot of glamour in advertising. It's one of the tools that they use. But if we look at the way the word has been used and at the history of the phenomenon, the earliest form of glamour is military glamour. People have a certain vision of what it is to be a soldier, the glamorous ideal that combines courage, patriotic significance, male camaraderie, a sense of a life that is greater than the average life. And the phrase glamour of battle was one of the first uses of the term the way we use it today in this sort of metaphorical sense.
Idealizing such a horrible thing. I mean, not that there's anything horrible about having a military. We live in a world where we need one. But the day-to-day work of the military is pretty horrible. You're out killing people or trying to keep yourself from being killed. To make that glamorous is a challenge, I would think. And yet, without it, you don't have soldiers.
Well, I mean, there is also in the American tradition an idea of war as work, which is a less glamorous idea.
Mm-hmm. The citizen soldier, which is different.
But this is a, you know, this is an ancient tradition. In the book, I talk about Achilles and Alexander going all the way back, but I also, you know, also talk about aviators who may be military or maybe not, but certainly that's an element mm-hmm. of it. So that's just using one example, and this is used, you know, to this day in recruiting ads, and it's this use of taking the elements that are real, the elements that are attractive, but then hiding the less attractive elements at the same time.
Doesn't it also confuse a little bit glamour and glory? If you look at the motivations of the soldiers, and if you look at how genius generals like Napoleon used the desire for glory and the recognition of glory to motivate his troops, you know, he could use little bits of ribbon to turn people into heroes. Isn't there a difference?
Well, I would say that the desire for glory is one of the elements that creates the glamour. It's not the only thing. I mean, because, for example, the desire for camaraderie is just as important to many people, mm-hmm. more important in some ways, or the desire to belong to an elite. I talk about the Marines using the few, the proud, as a way of appealing to the same underlying desire that, you know, other people find in the idea of getting into the hottest club in town. Mm-hmm. I mean, different people have different desires. I mean, this is one of the central points of the early chapters of The Power of Glamour, is that glamour, like humor, takes many different forms because it is a matter of tapping into people's desires. And different people have different desires, and they respond to different ways of representing mm-hmm. those desires. So many people have this inchoate longing to be part of an elite. For one person, the glamorous vision of that is getting into Harvard. For another person, it's joining the Marines. For another person, it's, you know, going to the Vanity Fair Oscar party or something like that. It depends on what your references are, and it depends on what other desires you have. So, for example, going back to the idea of glory, if you want to be part of the elite and you want a kind of glory, especially something that's associated with ideals of masculinity and physicality and heroism, then the military is going to be much more compelling to you as a glamorous ideal than, you know, going to the Vanity Fair Oscar party.
Right. Well, you know, to go from one extreme to another, you know, from the military end, you state in your book that every little girl dreams of being a princess, which is the kind of phrase I'm sure designed to earn you brickbats from radical feminists. You note that in 2011, Disney sold $3 billion worth of Disney princess merchandise. Talk to us a little bit about that princess phenomenon.
In the book, I have these theory chapters. That may be theoretical, that may be delving into something like what's the nature of mystery and glamour, or they may be historical. And then at the end of each chapter, I have two sidebars called icons, one of which what is on the princess. So in the princess as an icon of glamour, the representation of something glamorous, it says two things. It says, you are special and life can be wonderful. And whether you're talking about little girls, you know, four-year-olds mm-hmm. who want to dress up in sparkly dresses and dream of being princesses, or whether going back to the 1920s, you're talking about, you know, women looking at ads for, you know, Pond's cold cream endorsed by various obscure European princesses. This is this ideal of a life beyond the ordinary. And it has very little to do with especially over time, with anything having to do with real princesses. Once upon a time, the fact that princesses were so much richer than everyone else, literal aristocracy mm-hmm. was involved in the ideal. Today, it is mostly an ideal for children. And it's very akin to another glamorous archetype that I talk about, which is the superhero.
Mm-hmm.
It's this way that people can imagine being special. They can imagine having a wonderful life. And what that means if you're, you know, a 4-year-old girl is not the same thing that it means if you're a 40-year-old a female attorney. And a lot of times, the mothers forget that. And it's often the case, and you talk to a lot of parents, and I hear these stories over and over again, that it's a temporary phase, which is often nowadays superseded by a superhero phase. So it's not, contrary to what a lot of sort of feminist mothers fear, little girls don't associate the ideal of the princess nowadays with being passive and waiting mm-hmm. for, you know, some
Prince Charming to come
man
along.
To rescue them. It's just part of the ideal of being special.
You know, you talk about the persuasive power of glamour. And at one point you made a remark that science fiction is the technology as romance novels are to marriage, a form of propaganda. That spoke to me in so many ways because science fiction was such a big part of my diet as a young boy, which helped direct my career choices. Talk a little bit about romance novels. I mean, how does that use glamour and what is it selling?
Well, that's actually a quote from the editor of Technology Review who is deriding science fiction.
Hmm.
And I don't think it's fair to science fiction, which I know much better than I know romance novels. But the idea is that in both cases, you have worlds portrayed where the difficulties of negotiating everyday life have been edited away. And this is on the cusp between glamour and romance, not in the boy meets girl sense, but in the literary sense. Glamour is like a still photo. That one perfect scene, or whether it's an actual physical image or an image in our mind, and we project ourselves into it, and it sort of represents an ideal. So, for example, I did a big survey of Star Trek fans going to science fiction, and one of the things that's interesting that you discover when you delve into the sort of glamour that fans find in Star Trek is that it's not just about adventure or even, exploration, technology, the things that are obvious. It's also about a glamorous ideal of the perfect workplace. That mm-hmm. here is a workplace where everybody has a role and everyone is valued. You're not working with people who deride
you. It's an awesome team with no losers.
Bosses. Yeah. There's not, idiot coworkers. It's kind of this great place to work, and it represents a sort of ideal meritocratic workplace.
But it's not real.
But it's not real because it's always the case that in the glamorous image, even in a very good workplace, there are always going to be things that are annoying. There are going to be deadlines that are unpleasant. There are going to be days that you're doing routine stuff. And in any kind of glamorous image, those things are always going to be plagued down. That's where the grace, this artificial disguise comes in.
You say that offering foreplay, not fulfillment, glamour heightens desire. Doesn't actually deliver on it, but it just heightens that yearning.
Right. It's a matter of heightening yearning. And there are two ways that we use glamour in our lives. One is just to enjoy it. And a lot of the time, we just enjoy looking at, imagining ourselves on vacation in some beautiful spot, looking at pictures of, kitchens that, are as big as our house and thinking, wow, it would be really great to have that kitchen and, think of the entertainment.
Yeah, I call it kitchen porn.
Cars or imagine being, a great athlete or a great dancer or whatever. So that's just this sort of imaginative respite. And the other thing we do with glamour is we actually sometimes act on it. It directs us in a certain way. And that's where it can be both extremely valuable and extremely dangerous. It can point us in a very useful direction in our lives or even as a society by showing something that really does speak to our deep longings. And one of the things I talk about a lot in the book is the way this happens with careers. People see some image that is idealized, often a TV show or a movie, and they get the idea that, you know, they would like to be a lawyer, or they would like to be a forensic scientist, or they would like to, you know, work in the White House, whatever it might be. And they pursue that career. Now, along the way, obviously, all the things that are hidden in the TV version, let's say, you know, have to come back into play because you're living in reality. But for many people, this is, in fact, a very valuable way of seeing something that will speak to them, even when the disadvantages are edited back in. So, I mean, one of the stories I tell in the book is about Oprah Winfrey, which is also an example of finding glamour in something that was not intended to be glamorous. When Oprah Winfrey was a teenager, she found the Mary Tyler Moore Show incredibly glamorous. She says she wanted to be Mary. She wanted to live where Mary lived. She wanted Mr. Grant as a boss. So this picture of a TV newsroom that was in the sitcom, to her, was very glamorous, even though the show was a situation comedy whose comedy was based on embarrassing situations. Very unglamorous type of genre and form. And yet she saw something in that that spoke to her, and she pursued that career. Now, in fact, it turned out that Oprah Winfrey was not an especially good TV news reporter. I mean, she wasn't bad, but she, after some initial successes, almost crashed and burned until she found her
place.
Somebody had the bright idea to put her in a talk show format, and then that obviously turned out to be her métier. But this was a case where she was living in very poor, abusive, difficult, and very narrow circumstances, where the ability to see this glamorous ideal pointed her in a direction
that she
would not have found in her everyday life.
We all have examples of that in our lives. Is everyone susceptible to glamour, or are some of us immune the way some people are humorless?
Well, I do say that some people have a greater sense of glamour than others, in the same way that some people have a greater sense of humor than others. But I think people are far more affected by glamour. I think most people are, in fact, affected by glamour. And a lot of people who think they're immune to it just have defined it in too narrow a way. They sort of have defined it so that only the kinds of glamour that appeal to other people count. So in my libertarian world, when I'm giving talks, like I gave a talk at the Cato Institute about the book, you know, I talk about, you know, Ayn Rand. And Ayn Rand was a woman who really understood glamour, was really affected by it herself. It had a lot to do with the glamour of the, I mean, just plain old Hollywood glamour had a lot to do with why she came to America in the first place, why she, you know, came to Los Angeles, worked in the movies. She had a glamorous idea of being a writer. She had a glamorous idea of sort of an ideal type of person, physically as well as intellectually.
It gave her a psychic energy.
Yeah. And in her work, she created glamorous archetypes. And so to this day, you know, there are libertarians who want to create gulch on Earth, even though that is an example of, you know, an escape from the mundane that is pure glamour. It leaves all kinds of things out. But it really appeals to people's deep yearnings to have a place where they are with like-minded people in, you know,
a better world.
And the institutions are free and, you know, all that kind of thing.
You know, one of the most interesting parts of the book that I found was your analysis of politics. You know, you stated that the most recent exemplar of glamour was not a movie star or a fashion plate, but a presidential candidate. What makes Barack Obama so glamorous?
Well, Barack Obama was glamorous in 2008. I don't think he's especially glamorous today, and that's actually a big part of the story. In 2008, he was very unusual because he was a glamorous political candidate. Charismatic political candidates are common. In fact, to be successful, you have to have a certain level of charisma. But glamour is very unusual in politics because our politics demand a kind of disclosure and knowledge of candidates that is really incompatible with glamour.
The less glamorous president was Kennedy. It's been a long time.
Glamour requires a kind of mystery. So I do make some comparisons between Barack Obama in 2008 and John Kennedy in 1960. It's not just that he was young and good-looking and, you know, that sort of thing. It's that he had a short history, public career, so people could project onto him all different kinds of
hopes,
possible meanings. And people projected onto Obama in 2008, his supporters, all their hopes and dreams, what they saw in him, what they wanted in a president, what they wanted in a country, what they wanted in a world. They projected onto him sometimes contradictory points of view. He still is a very self-contained individual, but he was self-contained. He was mysterious. And because of that, he was able to be very glamorous. And his background played into that in the same way that Kennedy's background played into his glamour. In Kennedy's case, it was, you know, he was from this very unusual family, and he was rich, and it was, you know, a kind of life very removed from normal American life, but appealing. And in Obama's case, it was this, you know, biracial parentage, international upbringing, which in a different way was removed from typical American life, but again, in a very positive way for supporters. Supporters saw in that a representation of the world that they would like to live in, a world that was where race was not an issue, where, you know, Americans were comfortable internationally. And so people projected onto him their hopes and dreams, and often contradictory views. And even when they weren't contradictory, they were often sort of greater than any one person could possibly deliver, including the idea that all political conflict would magically somehow disappear. And so once he got in office, it makes it very difficult to be president. It's a great, glamour is a great asset when you're running for president, but when you get elected and you have to make decisions and you have to alienate some people, you know, or at least disappoint or disillusion some people, there's a sort of letdown. And also, as I say, a lot of his supporters sort of imagined that he would eliminate political conflict, and that, of course, didn't happen either. Obviously, he got reelected, but I think that the reelection had more to do with people disliking the opponent than with people having that same kind of intense passion for him and what he represents.
If you look at the breakdown of the presidency, and I look deeper into your book, you called glamour a reality distortion field, which is how we used to describe Steve Jobs' persuasive powers.
Right.
What happened to Barack's persuasiveness? No one's, even his own party doesn't seem to be persuaded anymore.
Well, I think this is the disadvantage of glamour, which he's still, you know, he's still well-spoken. He can still give a speech when he, you know, gets up for it. But people are no longer seeing in that what they used to see. So I think this is the, sort of the disadvantage of that intense glamour that he had in 2008. It's almost sort of like they've gone over to the opposite side. They were so emotionally engaged that they've kind of
gone too far the other way.
Lost it completely. As opposed to, you look at some a very different type of character like Bill Clinton, who was intensely charismatic and not particularly glamorous. You know, he could somehow always use that force of personality to get people to, you know, pay attention. And people had not projected onto him quite the...
Well, he was a flawed character from the beginning, and people just seemed to accept his flaws and almost revel in them.
He was, you know, he was this very appealing to his supporters version of an ordinary person. And that's an easier thing to sustain than being some kind of, you know, a representation of the ideal.
So, Virginia, what do you want people to take away from this analysis of glamour?
I want people to see the world with new eyes. I want people to see the ways in which glamour pervades our society and our culture and how it affects each and every one of us in our lives. And I want them, as a result of that, to enjoy glamour more, but also to see the ways in which it might be misleading. So, I like to say glamour can only be a guide, not a destination. Mm. This book is not saying glamour is good or glamour is bad. It depends on how it's used and what's done with it. But it is a very powerful and very pervasive force and deserves to be understood and appreciated.
So enjoy the manipulation, but realize you're being manipulated.
Right.
Virginia, thanks so much. It was a delight reading the book and chatting with you today. Thanks for being on the show.
Thank you.
That wraps up our program. It's been our pleasure chatting with Virginia Postrel, author of The Power of Glamour, who helped us dig under the surface of this ubiquitous phenomenon. I'm your host, Bill Frezza, here on Real Clear Radio Hour, brought to you by the Competitive Enterprise Institute. Please join us on Bloomberg Radio every Saturday at 10 a.m. and again at 6 p.m. and online at realclearradio.org. See you next week.